Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. It's Ken Reed here, and you are listening to TV Guidance Counselor. Hopefully you didn't do that by accident. I don't really know how you would, given how one obtains podcasts, but perhaps you have. If it's by accident, I am Ken Reed, your Boston comedian and host of TV Guidance Counselor, the podcast in which someone picks a classic edition of TV Guide from my vast collection of back issues. They write down what they'd watch that week in history. They hand me the guide. They have their list, and we discuss their choices. I am newly rejuvenated. I have just gotten back from Los Angeles, where I had an excellent time. I went to Slashback Video, which is a art installation of an old video store, which was cool, but also made me feel incredibly old. I went to the David Lynch Festival of Disruption, which was pretty exciting. I got to see the new documentary about Grace Jones, which is something I highly recommend, and Grace Jones was there. I got to do a virtual Twin Peaks thing where I went through the Red Room. It was all incredibly fun, and I have a suitcase full of episodes for you. And again, I want to thank everyone who participates in the Patreon. You can go to patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor because your monthly gift is one of the major factors as to why I can go to California or go to New York and get these episodes. I always try to grab people when they come through Boston, but sometimes people don't come through that often. So I head out to LA and I get episodes there. And this episode is one I recorded in LA. My guest this week is Megan Duffy. You probably know Megan, or at least I knew Megan initially from Blumhouse's Fear Initiative. She's also been on Mad Men. She's been in a ton of commercials. She does everything. She is a producer. She directs. She does all kinds of stuff and is really fascinating, really fun. I had a great time talking to her. If you don't listen to Blumhouse's Fear Initiative podcast, definitely check that out wherever you found this podcast. And she's in a movie coming up in Christmas. It's a Christmas horror comedy called All the Creatures Were Stirring, which is out December 4th. That is right up my alley, so I'm very excited about that, given my proclivity for Halloween and Christmas specials, I guess I would call it. That's All Creatures Were Stirring, December 4th. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode with my guest, Megan Duffy.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Megan Duffy, how are you?
Hi, I'm good.
Thank you for trekking up to the hills here.
It was a 2-mile drive for me, so it wasn't that. Yeah, I mean, I did drive. I guess I could have walked, but
maybe. But weirdly, here, like 2 miles, you're like, oh, it's 2 miles, and then
it'll take you like 6 hours.
Minutes.
Yeah,
yeah. The hills freak me out. This is as high as I can go up here and not be totally freaked out.
It's a really pretty view.
It is really nice, but like I've driven up further up there and been like, I don't know what's happening. I'm completely lost.
The worst is when someone, you get invited to a house party and it's late at night and it's that like narrow.
Yes.
And you're like, oh, I might be driving to my death.
Yes.
I might fall off the end of this cliff. Or what if my car gets stuck? Or
right.
What if there's a mudslide? Like in Malibu, there will sometimes be like a mudslide. And
oh,
you're like,
yeah.
I can't get past this.
Or like a rock tumble that just comes down. Or like whenever I'm out here, I'm like, oh, how did drunk actors in the 50s find anything?
That's why they all got into car accidents.
They really did, yeah. Because I'm like, I have my GPS and I still have no idea where I am. Like every time I take a turn, I'm like, is this someone's driveway? Like I am always like, I'm at someone's house and I didn't know it.
Yeah, well, especially now with Waze, sometimes it directs you through weird things. Like recently I was in the car and it said, turn left down alley. And I'm like, this is a premise for a horror film. I'm obviously going
to
die.
Like some guy hacked into Waze and is just having people to rob come to him.
I feel like that's like, an amazing premise.
My house.
That's an amazing premise for a horror film.
Let's sell it. We just made $1 million.
Oh,
right.
Wow.
We're two
okay. Should
in.
We stop talking about it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. Maybe. Yeah. We'll write
well,
this
I don't
out.
Want anyone to steal our idea.
That's true. Well, what I'll do is I'll print out the transcript and then I'll mail it to ourselves registered mail. And then that counts as a copyright, even though that's not legally binding in any way.
Sounds good. You heard it here first.
You heard it here first. Timestamped.
Our idea.
When the Ways hacker murder movie happens, it was us. Yeah, you could do that. Like, it would be like a high tech Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah.
Where they just have cars coming in.
You could even do it as like a short, like a proof of concept.
That's true.
Thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, shoot kind of rogue at night.
Yeah.
A couple of like Sony A7s.
It's like home delivery victims. Which should be, man. Or you could have like someone using like Postmates to see how far people will go for like the $4 they get for it.
I actually, I just came back from being at the Film Quest Film Festival in Provo, Utah.
Oh, yeah.
And I saw this really amazing short film this kid Alex made about this like Uber Eats driver who's down on his luck and his star rating is low. And he ends up delivering food to this house. And the woman he delivers it to, it seems like she is in distress. And without ruining too much, it turns out she's actually a murderer.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. And he kind of the situation works itself out. But then he goes back to the scene of the crime to rate himself 5 stars.
Oh,
so he doesn't
yes.
get fired.
Well, I mean, you might as well. Because, yeah. I mean, it's not going to happen otherwise.
Yeah. It was a great little short, though. I can't remember the name of it, but...
I cannot rate people badly. I can't do it.
So I will, normally everybody's 5 stars unless something terrible happens. So one time I was in an Uber and the guy picked me up in a Prius and he's
is
like,
that the terrible thing that happened?
Well, no, there's a lot of Priuses. Yeah. No, but why it's significant is because then he says to me like, oh, I just realized I'm almost out of gas. And where I was going, it was maybe 4 miles. So I was like, oh, okay, but I was a little drunk and I just wanted to be agreeable. Like, yeah. You women, we're always agreeable. And he's like, is it okay if I stop? And I was like, oh, there's a gas station like right by my house. Like, I'm thinking he's in a Prius, aren't they?
Yeah.
Don't they have like a backup battery?
He can make it 4 miles.
I think so.
Yeah.
And also, why'd you pick me up?
Right.
If you didn't have gas. So he pulls off this exit and we drive by a gas station. I was like, wasn't that one there? And he's like, oh, I like to go to this one that has the cheapest prices. And I just was like, oh, this is weird.
This is a murderer.
Weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then he goes inside the gas station and it's in some sketchy kind of part of like East Hollywood. He goes into the gas station and he's in there for 15 minutes.
What?
Yeah. And then he comes out and he gasses up and then he drives me home. He keeps the meter running the whole time. So it should have been a $7 ride.
Yeah.
Now ends up being like $25
what?
Or something. And I give him 1 star and I write to Uber and I explain to them what happened.
Yeah.
And they're like, we'll refund you the difference. So I got like $20 back. But it was the closest I've ever been to being kidnapped, I
yeah,
think. It had to be
horrifying.
A drug thing.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah,
yeah.
He was like fiending and he had to go in there and pick
or,
up his...
Or he was using the like Uber to like be a delivery.
I'm
going to
deliver drugs and get other people to pay me.
Yeah, I'm gonna use the system to
that's
make money
the,
delivering, double
I mean,
dipping.
Ugh, that's horrifying. Like the worst I ever had was I was doing a shoot and like the producer ordered me an Uber and it was a woman. And so when I showed up, I'm like, oh, this is the ride. And he's like, is your name Susan? And I'm like, no, she ordered it for me. So, you know, and he goes, oh, all right. And then, I made some joke because, you know, I'm like, oh, you know, always good to check. Mm-hmm. And he goes, I don't need your dumb comments about gender.
Whoa.
And I was like, whoa. And then he just cranked up this like really angry, sweary hip hop for the whole rest of the ride.
Oh, yikes.
Yeah. And even him, I was like, 5 stars. I don't want, you know where I live.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, there's been a couple times late at night where someone's been like, can I take you out sometime? And I'm like,
oh, that's great.
They get 4 stars.
Yeah. Okay. So that's
yeah.
a one
I'm
star.
Like, well,
yeah.
you got me home. But also, no.
Little flattered, little creeped out, yeah. 4 stars. Yeah.
Also, one guy really stunk of garlic, and I'm like, I feel bad.
Yeah.
But it was just like, so I am 4 stars.
Yeah.
But usually the rest of the time, 5.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's not an accurate scale, I'd say, is the point, maybe.
Yeah.
To get 1 star, you literally have to kidnap somebody.
Well, like I said, almost kidnapped.
It's very important. So immediately you were drawn to the fall preview here, which is October 1st to the 7th, 1988. And this is always...
Let's be honest, I was drawn to all of them.
That's true. That's true. It's
but
a hard
one,
choice.
This one, I just wanted to... Because the way fall previews work nowadays, especially because I work in TV, like it's so different than how it used to be. So that kind of was like hit the nostalgia button for
me. Yeah, because now we don't... I mean, the networks still do fall shows, but the season doesn't kind of exist anymore.
Right.
It's whenever they do it.
Yeah.
And this was so weird for people to understand that this was literally the first time you knew what shows were going to start, and you had a week in advance.
Yeah. And it was so exciting. It was I remember opening up this issue specifically. It's like, oh, what are we going to be treated to? Because we didn't have the internet to tell us in real time what just got greenlit.
They're not on the set tweeting about it. Like, you might get Entertainment Tonight would go there, or like, and you wouldn't really know what shows you love got canceled till this issue. Yeah. That was always depressing.
Yeah.
Find out later. The funniest thing here, I always like to look at the editor's choice in the fall preview, because these are what they think. These are going to be the huge shows. This is going to be it. They have a pretty good track record in this one. Roseanne, they pick. Uh-huh. They pick Empty Nest, which went on for a number of years. Dear John, mm-hmm. which you had not remembered.
But, no, it's what is it? Yeah. Judd Hirsch or something?
It's Judd Hirsch.
I don't think I watched that one.
It's a remake of a British series, and the premise is it's like middle-aged single people who are lonely have a support group twice a week.
I mean, honestly, I would watch that now. Yeah, that's like, I'm not that far from there.
The premise, you could probably remake this as a darker premise and it would be better, but it was like a pretty wacky sitcom. Mm-hmm. And like, actually the breakout character was named Kirk, and he was played by a guy whose name I'm forgetting, but is from Cambridge, Mass. He's a big theater actor, but Judd Hirsch was in it. So it was the first thing he did after Taxi and Ordinary People. So they were like huge hit, but it went on for like 3 seasons. Mm. Midnight Caller, which was Gary Cole as a radio DJ by night, crime solver by day, which is as great as it sounds.
He had two jobs. Yeah. That's how tough it was in the 80s.
It's a Reagan economy. Almost Grown, which was like a Wonder Years ripoff, but for like middle-aged yuppies. So okay. It was like 30-something Wonder Years. It didn't go very long. Paradise, starring Lee Horsley, is set in the 1890s. It was a cowboy show. Obviously didn't go very long.
Yeah, I mean, I do like a good cowboy show.
Are you a Western fan?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I watched Westworld.
Okay, Deadwood.
Deadwood is amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I saw Robin Weigert do a play a couple of years ago at the Mark Taper, I want to say, and she was a delight, and to see her do the role she did, which was just like a dysfunctional daughter in a family
right. In
Palm Springs.
like, a little different.
You know, you look at that and then you look at like her work on she's on, is it Big Little Lies?
Oh, yeah.
Psychologist. And then her Calamity Jane, it's just like, wow, she's got range.
Yeah. Wow. She's a versatile actor.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's funny to see people who you know for a very specific role and you're like, they're so good in this. They just have to be like that. They just must be that person. Mm-hmm. And then when you realize they're not, you're like, oh no, they have a skill. Yeah. This is very impressive. And then finally, Mary Tyler Moore had a CBS family sitcom that bombed big time. And Murphy Brown is the other one they pick.
It's funny. Roseanne and Murphy Brown are back again.
They're back again. Although Roseanne is Roseanne without Roseanne.
Yeah, well.
Just understandable.
Yeah.
Which she was always, I have to give Roseanne credit for, obviously that show wouldn't have gotten made if Roseanne didn't exist. Mm-hmm. And she did hire some amazing writers, like everybody who works in television comedy now, like Judd Apatow and like Dan Harmon, mm-hmm. and like the people, Joss Whedon, they all worked on that show. But she was always the worst part of the show.
Yeah.
Which makes sense because they hired amazing ensemble.
I mean, John Goodman and Laurie Metcalf, you know, and then the kids were all great. Both Beckys.
Yes,
Becky
both
and
Beckys.
Replacement Becky.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that was, I remember watching it as a kid, and like whenever Roseanne was on, I kind of rolled my eyes. She just, she's not like my mother, but there was just something, and I was, you know.
Which kind of worked because she felt like a real person.
Oh, yeah.
But not always in a good way.
No.
So you grew up in Connecticut?
I grew up in Connecticut, Massachusetts.
Okay, yeah. But that show, even though it was in Michigan, mm-hmm. felt more like kids I knew in my house and our houses growing up than any other show I can think of.
I mean, I feel like it felt like that, like, middle-class suburbia kind of, we all go to public school.
Right.
We all have to wait at the bus stop in the snow.
Yeah.
That kind of, that culture, which, you know, you found it in the Midwest. You also found it on the East Coast.
Right.
Less so in the South because they had better weather.
It's true.
But
never really got, it doesn't get represented that much in family shows or shows with kids, I feel like. Kids shows, at least when we were growing up, mm-hmm. were all like, I skateboard, my locker's outside.
It was really like California. Well, it's because they shot in California. Yeah, yeah. So it would be very expensive to create a New England village.
That's true.
I think, and, you know, have things like elements and weather.
Right. Why would you?
Yeah. And I guess New York is where another's where they film a lot of stuff. But you never hear about someone wanting to go and shoot a new sitcom in like Iowa.
No. I wonder if it's just that they don't have the infrastructure there. Although there was a weird, after Cheers ended, the executives were like, Cheers was popular, not because it was a great ensemble with amazing writing. It was set in Boston. Mm-hmm. So let's set all these shows in Boston for no reason. And then they all bombed and they were like, Boston must be played out. Set them all in Chicago. It was like, you don't think you understand what made these shows work. Yeah. And there was like 5 years where everything was set in Chicago and they all bombed. And they were like, I guess it's back to New York and LA. I don't know what to do. It was like,
you
yes.
make a good show.
That's why you're executives. Yeah. people will watch anything in Boston. Yeah. No. Not true.
Yeah, not true.
We all watched Boston Public. And man, was that not Boston Public, Boston Common. With Anthony Clark.
I missed that one. Boston Public
was good.
It was a like a teen kind of dramedy. There was a bunch of kids, and Taryn Manning was one of her early breakout roles.
David E. Kelly, I think, did it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Boston Public was good. Boston Common was a sitcom that like was one of those shows where they, with the must-see TV night, they were like, we can put anything at 9 o'clock and people will just watch it because they like the 8:30 and 9:30. And so it lasted like way longer than it should have. And it was about a Southern guy who chased his sister to was supposed to be Emerson College. And he's Southern. He doesn't understand Boston. That's it. That's the whole premise of that show.
Cool.
Yeah.
So, it awesome.
It is not fun. And two guys, a girl, and a pizza place. I forgot. Ryan Reynolds.
Oh.
That was Boston.
Oh, yeah. Not, oh, wow.
Yeah.
And a pizza place.
Oh, and then they dropped the pizza place. SNL had a funny sketch at the time where they did a show that was just the pizza place. Because after they had dropped it from the title, they were like, the breakout star. Yeah, it was like the pizza place. But the first episode of that was like, they were trying to sneak into a Celtics game or something. And then they like never mentioned Boston again.
It was like, funny. So, because the Red Sox, are they going to the World Series?
I think
again?
So. Yeah.
So, when I was a kid, my grandma was a diehard Red Sox fan. Like, Red Sox teddy bears all over the place.
Yep.
Dad was a Yankees fan.
Oh, dear God.
Did you, right. So
his mother?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I remember being somewhere and there was a game on. It might have even been that we were at Fenway, but I just remember my dad wearing Yankee blue and we were surrounded by Red Sox fans and people were really mean to us and like yelling.
Oh, yeah.
And so I grew up thinking people who like sports were bad. And it turned out, oh no, my dad just was kind of an asshole.
He was he was in. He knew what he was getting into, and he dragged you guys in with him.
Well, no, I think it was more his attitude was just kind of like, well, I like it, so and it's funny. I learned a lot about like my sense of self. Well, I like it, and that's okay, and I'm allowed to express myself, although. You know, there are like social cues sometimes that you have to pay attention to.
Yeah, there's the self-preservation that kicks in sometimes too, where you're like, I really like this. Maybe I shouldn't like it there. I could still like it, but they don't have to know.
Yeah.
Those games are, and they've only gotten worse. Like the people are just the most hateful, awful people. And it doesn't reflect on us well.
No. No, I do like baseball though.
Have you gone to games out here?
Yeah, I'm in a Dodger game. I think there's nothing more fun. Like even if you're in the cheap seats, you know, you get like a bag of the roasted peanuts and you have a beer. I usually get like rosé or something, but it's fun. And
it seems traditional, like what people talk about a baseball game where they're not like just ready to fight everybody.
Well, yeah, because it's not fast paced like with basketball. Because I'm a Clippers fan and for a while I had access to courtside seats, which was cool.
Nice.
But you know, but you're constantly, it's moving in the game. Start and you have to drop your conversation, but in baseball it's kind of so slow moving that you get to spend a lot of time getting to know people, talking about life. I love everybody gets up and stretches and things like that, and you get this kind of sense of community.
So it's more like a social, it's more social than like what happened, what just happened.
Yeah, I mean, I have no idea who's won the game. A lot of times I miss the big things that happen and then I hear people go then I like you just replay it though.
I'll watch it later. It's fine.
Yeah. Or just on that big screen above where the actual action happens.
Well, they have the screen here.
Yeah, exactly.
When did you move out here? How long have you been out here?
Like a while.
Okay. Yeah. Do you feel
14 years?
like you live here now? Or did you feel New England East Coasty? Or were you kind of
I hated it.
Yeah.
Well, I liked the first 7 years of my life. I grew up in Springfield, Massachusetts. Yeah. And so I went to a public school that was really diverse. There were five kids who would be with us for homeroom and end of the day, and then they'd disappear because they got their classes in Spanish. And
yeah.
I wanted to go and sit in and see what they were doing. And when we'd have our Christmas assembly, there would be a group of kids who weren't Christian, so they would go and do something else during that time. And it was just so fascinating to me, the diversity.
Because Springfield, if people don't know, it sounds like an idyllic little New England town, but it's a big metropolis. It's like a big city for the most part.
They just got a casino.
They just got a casino.
They put an MGM in.
Yep, they absolutely did. Only place anyone's ever pulled a gun on me, Springfield, Massachusetts.
Yeah, that didn't happen to me, but most of the people that I know did.
Yeah, Basketball Hall of Fame.
Basketball Hall of Fame is there. They moved it across the street. But yeah, that was always really cool to drive past it on the freeway. But yeah, then I was like, when I was seven, my dad had gotten a job at Lego, which was headquartered at the time in Enfield. And so I think my parents were, and also we had like a two bedroom house, and we had a little, my brother came along, and they were like, well, we need to expand.
Yeah.
So they built us a house in Enfield, Connecticut on this like cul-de-sac that just where you could pick like seven, there's like six or seven different colors of houses and like four different styles, and everybody built their house how they wanted it, but they all looked the same.
Yep.
And and I think my parents thought like, well, this is a much safer place, and it was, but I was so bored. Like day one at school, I looked around and everyone was like dressed the same and looked the same. I'm like, okay, how do I get out of here?
Right.
Like at seven, I'm like, all right, I'm going to start planning my escape. But one of the things was like, I found like art and dance. And so instead of like hanging out with kids, I would like lock myself in my bedroom and work on a dance piece. I'm like, this is going to be the one. I'm going to win an award. I'm going to get out of here.
New York scholarship.
Yeah, I was on scholarship at Broadway Dance Center in New York for a while.
Out.
Yeah, yeah. So it didn't work out. Yeah. But ultimately, I wanted to go to NYU, and my mom was convinced that if I moved to New York, that I was going to get murdered.
Of course. That's what people from not New York in the north of New York think.
Well, she'd been a bus stewardess, I think, in the 70s, and had a story about getting off at like the Port Authority in New York and having to step over a pool of blood where someone had just been stabbed. So that was kind of her experience with
Hold
the city.
On a moment. A bus stewardess?
There used to be bus stewardesses,
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. She's still got like the little bag. I have the cape that she used to wear.
Little hat.
Her uniform. I don't know if there were hats, but there were capes.
Capes is good.
Yeah.
I think people need to bring back capes. Do you ever wear the cape?
I have a couple of capes.
Yeah. Capes should make a comeback. I think you could pull off capes.
I mean, if you're going to the right parties, they're already making that comeback.
That's my problem. No one's inviting me to these things. That is my problem.
Now we're friends.
Now we know. So you have to let me know next cape party, because I would love to wear a cape.
All right.
But that's, I'm just going to throw that out there.
Yeah.
What'd you rate for the first night here on Saturday? Anything on? Who's the boss? They had moved this to Saturdays from Wednesdays, which is really weird.
Well, it was probably, they're like, we're not quite ready to cancel it, but we don't really think they're watching anymore.
And it went on for another four seasons after this. And it went on a season after Tony and Angela got together, which is always the kiss of death, literally. Like, no one cares about the show anymore. Once the will they, won't they is a will they.
Yeah.
I can't think of a show that people liked as much or still liked after the main characters hooked up.
I mean, The Office still, I think, kind of.
Oh,
but
yeah.
You had a huge ensemble for that. You didn't have just the two.
Yeah, you could move on to other people. X-Files, maybe. Although everyone hated that when that happened.
How delightful was Judith Light?
She was great. Yeah. And she actually...
She's amazing and transparent.
She's amazing and transparent. She's like such an amazing advocate for all kinds of things. Mm-hmm. But weirdly, there's a Worcester Outlets mall, and she was friends with the owner of this mall. And they redid it in the late 80s, early 90s. And her face is all over this mall. So they just took it down like last year, but it would you'd walk into this mall and it's like, Judith Light says, shop in Worcester. Like, Worcester is great. And it was so weird because you're like, why is Judith Light? I mean, cool, but what an odd thing. And she was just helping her friend out.
One of the first like Q&A discussions I ever went to when I first moved here was Judith Light talking about her career to like a group of like 50 to 100 people or something, and talking about how all of the things she said she would never do, like she, her, but what was it, Guiding Light or something was yeah. her big, that she swore off soap operas, but that she hadn't booked a job in something like 8 months. And yeah. I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I can only act. And then this opportunity coming along and not wanting to take it, but then saying, well, but I need the cash. And then it led her really to where she is. And it was moderated by, I can't remember, he was a theater director. And he was talking about how he had read her on things and how she had been the best actor on a, in a play that he was casting, but that she didn't get the job. And I thought that was really an interesting perspective to right. him. Like, but if you were the best, you should get it.
Yeah.
And so it's just really eye-opening and hearing her talk about her career and super inspiring.
That's the kind of thing where you come out here and you go to that kind of thing and you go, oh, it's awesome out here. Mm-hmm. You just go.
Yeah. And it's like, no, I'm yeah. going to... I can live my dream. I just have yeah. to stick with it. It's yeah. going to be okay.
If I get a job okay. on Guiding okay. Light, take it.
Yeah.
There's who's the bosses for all of us.
Well, I feel like that a little bit with like my horror career.
Yeah.
Like I was like, I'm never going to do a horror film. I'm never going to do any nudity. And
was
then,
Maniac the first one?
The first horror film. Yeah. I mean, I was doing comedy. I was doing a bunch of like commercial work and then sometimes getting yeah. up on stage.
What was the UCB. Burger King ads were before that?
That was after.
After. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we filmed them after, but I had had something like 13 pins or avails in a row for jobs where, you know, I'm the second choice right. or the backup, whatever. And then Maniac came along and I was like, all right, fuck it, I'll do it.
Yeah.
And yeah. And then a few months later, I was on a plane to Cannes.
Yeah.
Like, okay, this were a good idea.
Did you like horror stuff when you were growing up?
Yes and no. Like I didn't really get into the Friday the 13th right. franchise,
slashery.
But I remember really liking Nightmare on Elm Street,
yeah.
but mostly because I thought there was like really intelligent humor in it.
Yeah.
And like psychological kind of like Signs of the Lambs, things like that, but
right.
just straight like gory for the sake of,
ooh,
you know,
that hurts.
Yeah. Movies. Or like, yeah. you know, chick running around in her underwear through yeah. the woods. Like, oh, here we go again. Like that didn't really. And it's mostly too, I would look at the acting and the performances and I'm like, why, she's not believable.
Right.
You know,
like how most kids watch those things.
Yeah. But then you get something like the Birds or like Rosemary's Baby
yeah.
And, you know, those are just fantastic, well-performed films. So.
And even like Nightmare on Elm Street, like, cause you produce music videos for mm-hmm. a long time, the sort of fantasy, like the kill scene, the dream sequences are very rock video-ish
yeah.
in the sort of surreal stuff and stuff. So I wonder if that may have also appealed in
well,
some
I mean,
way too.
I just remember liking, who is the actor who plays Freddy Krueger and all those?
Robert Englund.
I just thought he was great.
Yeah,
he's like his sense of humor and, you know, that he's kind of like, he's in on the joke.
Yeah. You
like
had
Freddy
to be.
Is in on the joke. Yeah.
At that point, it became such a cultural phenomenon. You had to kind of address it and lean into it,
mm-hmm.
Which was an interesting move. Cause when I look back, in 88 was kind of the height of it. They had Freddy dolls and like, which this sounds silly that this was a big deal now because people go and can buy every horror movie, mm-hmm. no matter how horrific it is, as a toy.
Yeah.
But it was weird to have kids' toys for a movie that's about a child murderer who's
yeah.
a burn victim
yeah.
Who kills you in your nightmares. But it just, but yeah, it became this really weird cultural phenomenon. And it was, I don't know how that happened.
Yeah. It's funny. Every year at the Blumhouse Halloween party, there is no less than 9 guys dressed as Freddy Krueger. And usually you try and round them up to take a picture together.
Do they think they're going to show up and be the only one?
Oh, no. I think they're like looking for their community.
Right.
They're like, who thinks like me?
Let's find some other Freddys here.
Yeah.
What's the best costume you've ever seen at one of those parties?
There was one year that Jason Blum showed up as the Wicked Witch of the West in full green hat. And no one knew it was him. And like, I was doing that, like, that's Jason, like, holy shit. And, but yeah, no one knew it was him. And that was just, it was so spectacular because he just got to hang out at his own
right.
party, but not be like bothered by people wanting to pitch anything. It was
right.
just like, I'm just,
just yeah. hanging out. It's like when yeah. Michael Jackson went out in disguise.
Yeah. Yeah. Except Halloween. What are you going to be for Halloween?
I don't know.
This is my airway
yeah,
after.
No,
so.
Yeah. But I have trouble coming up with anything good. And the weirdest thing, I love horror movies. I love Halloween, hate haunted houses, and I've always been like super lazy about costumes.
Mm.
Well, because there's not a lot of places to go. And like,
well, I guess in Boston
yeah.
to go full out in a Halloween costume as a man
yeah.
doesn't go over as well as it does in LA.
Yeah. Like I often go for like a Gomez Adams kind of thing
because
it's super
yeah.
easy.
That's
a go-to. For a long time, my go-to was a priest because I had black shirts and like white cardboard. That was like an easy one.
Yeah.
But I've never done anything real elaborate as an adult. What did you have a thing in mind this year?
This year I'm going to be Isabelle Adjani from Possession.
From Possession?
Yeah.
Oh my God. Specific Possession scene?
Yeah. Okay. I found an almost identical blue dress.
Wow.
On Etsy. I was very excited because I've been kind of looking around for a while, and then I found one. You know, it's kind of navy, and it doesn't have quite the same high neck, but it's right. close enough.
People will
and
know.
Then I got a wig, and I have a hairstylist friend who's gonna kind of cut it to the right, and then we're just gonna put some blood. So she's not gonna be full vomit because I don't right. want to ruin the dress. I'd yeah. like to wear it again, but
that's fantastic. Yeah. I love Isabelle Adjani in general, and that movie. I remember seeing that movie and just being like, I don't know what just happened to my brain.
Oh my God. I mean, that scene in the, well, she couldn't, and she ended up not being able to work for a couple of years after.
It traumatized her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it would traumatize me.
It's just traumatic watching it.
Yeah. Just in what dark place she had to go through yeah. to, you know.
Yeah, I think blah. Subway was the next movie she did with, which was with Christopher Lambert, and it was a Luc Besson movie, but it was like an action-y movie, mm-hmm. and it was as far away from Possession as you could get.
Yeah.
Sam Neill, it seemed okay.
Yeah. After that, well, but I mean that subway scene, oh, that's brutal. Is
yeah.
you know, but then there's part of me that's like, I want to play a role like that,
just to be able to go all out.
Yeah,
yeah,
and go all out. I did a short film recently called Seeing Green about I produced it with friends. It's about a cake shop owner who turns unsuspecting women into bridezillas. And
excellent.
So I'm the monster. So I got to, not quite as crazy as that, because this is just an 8-minute short film, and
right.
I think that subway scene in that is like 20 minutes long, just in its own. But yeah, I don't know, like kind of digging
being deep, just a big yeah, evil character,
like real scary.
Yeah,
yeah,
I imagine that would be just super fun as an actor to be.
Yeah, well, what she does though, I'm sure her body,
oh, that wasn't fun.
It,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, she's throwing herself around and is like clearly in the moment in yeah. that scene, which I don't know how you would even draw from anything, because it's unlike anything anyone would have experienced.
But then there's a little bit of it that looks like it's a Pina Bausch piece.
Yeah.
You know, just like a modern dance kind of. And if you set it to music and you took away the vomit and stuff, I'm like, it would actually be some. I feel like something that Pina Bausch would put out.
Yeah. Quote of the episode, set it to music and take away the vomit. I got a couple notes for you on this.
notes. It's like my dancer choreographer yeah. brain. It's like, well.
Do you ever, do you choreograph anything now? Or do you ever like?
I mean, I used to.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had a dance career as a teenager. And I did it, like my first audition in LA was to be a Clippers girl.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I made it to the end, which is, and then it was like me and a bunch of girls who, like, I didn't know. I'm like, oh, I'm just going to show up and be yeah. good at dancing. And they're like, and wear a two-piece thing. And it was like everyone had like cleavage
yeah.
and they tanned and they had full makeup. And I just came with like my fuzzy hair. Yeah,
I'm dancing.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, so I made it to that round,
and which then, is pretty impressive, having come in just as you.
Yeah, I guess. But I was in good shape, so like, yeah. But yeah, it was my first ever, and I also didn't really like it. Like the people I was meeting, I was like, oh, I don't know that this is my.
Oh, it sounds awful being like, you get paid very little, you work super
bucks.
Hard. Yeah,
$75 a performance, and no at the time, and no rehearsal pay.
Ugh, which is rehearsal times, what, at least 10 times more than the actual performance?
And they rehearsed like way down in Hermosa Redondo or something like
so
that.
So hours
it was like a
of
long,
driving.
Yeah.
We can't all be Paula Abdul.
No, no.
I think she was the only one that...
She was a Laker girl.
Oh, Laker girl. Yeah. You're right. Not the Clippers.
Different
yes.
sports team.
I know. This shows you how much I know. Right town though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, like, I can't think of a lot of other people who've gone on to be like householdy names from those kinds of gigs.
No, I mean, Jennifer Lopez,
Fly
was
Girl.
On, yeah,
yeah.
Living Color. I think you'd actually be surprised if you started really digging into the biographies of some actresses, how many of them came from. Didn't Neve Campbell, didn't she do ballet?
Yeah.
She's in that Robert Altman movie as a ballerina.
Yeah, a lot of them definitely started in dance.
Mm-hmm.
Or it's dancing or modeling. Those mm-hmm. seem to be the two sort of ins yeah. for a lot of
and
people that we know.
And sometimes both.
And sometimes both. Which is prescient here, because this Who's the Boss episode is the backdoor pilot for the modeling show that they started, which was a spinoff where Samantha got recruited to be a model with her best friend from Brooklyn, Leah Remini.
What? Oh, which... Yeah. which they would have been short to be models.
Way
right?
too short. Yeah. Yeah. But they were good actors. Holly yeah. Berry was in it. She was one of the models.
What show was that?
It wasn't Models Inc. Why am I, Living Dolls.
Living Dolls. Yeah. Oh yeah, now it's coming back.
One season was not a huge hit, but it was like all these models, teenage models, living in a house with like a house mother, and they backdoor piloted it through Who's the Boss, and Samantha was in the first two episodes, and then the ratings went significantly down from there. So, but Leah Remini did okay. So did Halle Berry.
Yeah, they're all right.
Yeah. Anything else that night?
I think that night a couple things. There was a Christopher Columbus movie that was on, which yes. no one would want to watch.
No, no. But this is from 1949, so it's probably super racist.
For sure. What else? There was actually a lot that Saturday night. There was like a William Friedkin movie starring Sigourney Weaver aired.
Oh yeah.
Deal of the Century.
Yes, this is, but with Chevy Chase as well. This is a comedy, action comedy. He plays an arms dealer, and it's one of like the least seen Chevy Chase 80s movies, but it's pretty good.
The Princess Bride was on that night. Is that on HBO, right?
Yeah. It's the premiere because it came out the year before. So this is the Saturday night premiere, cable TV premiere.
The Friday the 13th show?
The series, I loved. Have you ever seen it?
I have not. No.
It has nothing to do with the movies.
Okay, cool.
It's basically about people who hunt down haunted antiques. And David Cronenberg directed an episode.
Really?
Yeah. I love Cronenberg. It's his episode's really great. It's about like a faith healer.
I'm gonna have to look that up.
It's a cool show. It's very low budget. It's very Canadian. But it's a cool series because it's basically this guy sold the soul to the devil and owned an antique shop, and all of his antiques were cursed, and then he dies, and his niece and one of his other relatives are like, oh shit, we have to hunt down all these haunted antiques because all these people are going to die. And it's a pretty good premise for a series. I was so excited when this started because they were the trailers were just this ad basically where just the words Friday the 13th popped up on a tombstone, and then the series came out in lights, and that's all. And it might have just been because I don't think they knew what the show was yet.
Yeah.
But it was enough. I was like, this is great.
That would rope me in.
Yeah.
Also, that night, I would have had a hard time choosing between Who's the Boss and the Patty Duke Show.
So you're a big fan of the Patty Duke Show?
I loved the Patty Duke Show.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was on Nick at Night.
Yeah. It was like the staple of it. It was my favorite of the Nick at Night shows, I think, because like I didn't like My Three Sons. I didn't like Beaver that much. And Mr. Ed was kind of okay. But Patty Duke was fun.
Yeah.
And she's just so, like, she's just great. Mm-hmm. Like, she's so good in every scene.
Yeah.
And that show, weirdly, I don't think a lot of people have rediscovered. For, like, all the 50s shows that people have kind of rediscovered in the streaming age.
Yeah. Well, let's bring it back.
Yeah. We could do the Patty Duke show now.
Patty Duke show. I'm surprised they haven't remade it yet.
I'm surprised, too, especially with, like, The Parent Trap's just a ripoff of the Patty Duke Show.
Right.
And they've remade that like 7 times.
Yeah, at least.
Yeah.
At least.
So maybe they're like, I guess you couldn't call it the Patty Duke Show, so people wouldn't know it's a remake of the Patty Duke Show. That might be the barrier, actually, because they're like, we're remaking the show, but we're missing the name recognition of the title of the show. Because you'd have to call it like Cousins or something.
Yeah.
So it'd be super weird to have it called the Patty Duke Show.
Well, I guess you would find someone who is as strong of an actor and is charismatic.
Right.
And who has their own name. Because she had her own name recognition
at
the time. So you could recreate it, but with, you know, like somebody, I don't know, YouTube star names or
some YouTube star.
Or like someone on, like a Disney show.
Yeah, who's like graduated out of the Disney world.
Like the Ariana Grande show. I might watch that.
Or the Hilary Duff show, where she plays
she's
twins.
She's like in her 30s now.
Oh, that shows you how bad my reference frame
she's
is.
She's a little she grew up.
The Hailey Duff show. Was she older or younger? I don't know.
Her sister is slightly older.
Okay, well that works
she's
even
like,
less.
She's a cooking show, actually, so that does kind of exist. Yeah.
That works.
Yeah.
It's a cooking show, but with identical cousins, and you don't know which one's hosting that week.
And one has a terrible food allergy and the other doesn't. So it's that like anxiety. It's like, wait, roulette. She's eating the avocado. She's not allowed.
Oh, yes.
Where's her EpiPen?
We just made another $1 million right now.
We're coming with some great ideas.
What else do you have on there? Anything else on Saturday?
That was kind of it that stood out to me on Saturday. The Princess Bride premiering would have been a huge deal.
That is a huge deal because although a lot of us had video, if you were renting a new release, the chances were it was probably out. So yeah. When it's on TV.
Well, and then you could set the VCR and yeah. You could record it. Yeah. That's how I found Labyrinth. It's like, I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know it was in the theater. And then we found it on HBO. And then, you know, 2 months in, I had it memorized.
Yeah.
And we wore the tape out and had to re-record it.
That's what kids did. I mean, you'd find one thing you loved and just over and over and over again. And I don't know if they do that now.
I think they do.
I guess it's easier to do that now.
Yeah, you just hit repeat on your phone.
Yeah, but I wonder if they're like, because Labyrinth was probably one of like two tapes you had.
Yeah. So well, I had Labyrinth, I had Legend, I had some Disney stuff.
Only things that start with L.
Yeah.
Last of the Mohicans. Yeah.
My friends who have children will say that kids still, like, a kid picks a favorite song and that's, they just want to listen to it over and over again.
Yeah. That must drive parents completely insane.
Or they just, I think they just like conform.
You think they just give in?
Yeah.
That's a horror movie.
There was a, that's another one. Yeah. There's a friend of mine who, I saw her recently and she started kind of humming something to herself. I'm like, what are you humming? And she's like, oh, it's this hot dog song. And I'm like, what?
Hot dogs?
Goes, hot dog, hot dog, hot diggity dog. That's all the part I remember from it. But, yeah. and she's like, yeah. And she's like, you know, at first you're like, God, how many times do I have to listen to this? And she's like, but then by the end, you miss it.
Oh my God. That's chilling. That is a chilling revelation. Like you'd just be like, I'm so sorry for your loss.
That's why I have a cat and no babies.
The cat does not listen to her own music.
No, she does like music though.
Does she?
Yeah.
There is music for cats. Have you heard about that?
Yeah. There's also wine for cats.
Oh, how is it different?
Well, it's like catnip and cranberry or something. My cat hated it. She prefers the real stuff.
Why would you need that? You're like, this cat needs to relax.
Well, just say you're not drinking alone.
So you're drinking alone. I see, yes. Because I've seen those for dogs. They have like snacks shaped like beer bottles and stuff, which is like me and my buddies watching the game.
Well,
yeah.
Because, you know, if you're drinking alone, then it's like you might be an alcoholic. But if you've got someone drinking with you, then you're just a social
drinker. You're social, yeah. And for some reason, wine, even though wino is a word, seems less alcoholic-y because you're like, it's wine. People keep this in the cellar.
It's got antioxidants.
It's got antioxidants. It's in history.
Yeah.
Yeah. It has its own God.
Jesus endorsed wine.
I made wine. He wasn't making vodka. No. That's the problem.
No, the Russians made the vodka.
Yeah, and everyone knows they're evil.
All right, we're getting into dangerous territory here. Da, da,
yes,
da.
Yes. Although on? I will give them credit that they managed to make alcohol from potatoes.
Yeah, I mean, which is pretty. What can't potatoes do?
It's true, because you're like, grapes, sure, we do grape juice. Potatoes, you're not like, what can we do with this potato juice?
No, you wouldn't juice a potato, but gosh, you know what I made for dinner yesterday? Homemade french fries.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you pan fry them?
Uh-huh.
Wow.
In some oil, yeah.
Yeah. My God.
Yeah, that's garlic salt.
Ooh, Parmesan? Mm-hmm.
Just garlic salt.
Just garlic salt.
Yeah, I chew, I'm not a vegan, but I do a couple of days a week where I eat vegan, so that was one of them.
Had you made that before, or was this the first time?
Oh, I've made french fries before.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
This is a revelation right here. Yeah.
Delicious.
Is that your number one, is that your go-to cooking thing? Do you have, what's your, like, best dish?
Oh, gosh. It depends on who I'm cooking for.
Right.
You know, sometimes I just want to make a steak, but then I've got a lot of vegan friends, so I'll do, I've done, like, tacos, like a brown rice and lentil taco, sprouts and like homemade salsa.
Oh, wow.
I also do really good vegan nachos. But then like I make like orange chicken sometimes and I make it gluten free.
Man.
Yeah. I love to cook.
You should host this Patty Duke cooking show.
Maybe I will.
I think we found our star of the show. There we go. Yeah. Cause people would not be like, oh, Megan Duffy, clearly that's a good chef because of the bad reputation the Irish have for cooking, which is all we have.
I just make dishes out of potatoes.
Yes. Only potato dishes. Potatoes are very versatile.
Potato pancakes.
Yeah.
Potato tacos.
Potato donuts like they make in Maine.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I've never had one.
Maine is the number one grower of potatoes in America, even more than Idaho.
Whoa.
Which a lot of people don't know. And kids still get 2 weeks off every year to pick potatoes during potato season in Maine.
I love that.
Very strange. But they put potatoes in everything. They have a chocolate called a Napoleon. And it's kind of like an Almond Joy, but it's mixed with potato flakes too. It's pretty good.
Their donuts have potatoes in them.
Gnocchi. I bet they have good gnocchi.
Oh, gnocchi's really good. Yeah. Yeah. I made a sweet potato gnocchi once. So I was very pleased with my own skill set.
Trader Joe's has a cauliflower gnocchi.
Is it good?
Cauliflower. Yeah. Well, it needs it. It you need to definitely, once it's cooked, fry it up a little bit.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
And use, like, if you're not doing butter, you like olive oil and like salt.
You
and
need then some
it definitely
flavor.
Needs like a pesto or something on it. Because otherwise, you're like, oh, this is definitely tasting like cauliflower. But yeah. Once you throw a little pesto on it, it tastes like the real thing. You get the same sensation.
That's true for most things.
Yeah.
Just throw some pesto on it and you're fine. Especially pesto if someone has a pine nut allergy, you could save your house from them. It's like vampires with pine nut allergies. made a pistachio pesto once. Came out very good.
Pistachio.
Where are we? Sunday?
Sunday. We've just finished that, all of this to get to the end of Saturday.
Well, Saturday's a big night, though.
Yeah. You know what else was a big night that week, though? Sunday. You know why? The Liberace movie.
Yes, yes. Sorry, Andrew Stevens. Andrew Robinson, rather. Not Andrew Stevens.
And Rue McClanahan.
Rue McClanahan. This is ABC strikes first in the Liberace sweepstakes with a well-done 1988 TV movie that was produced with the blessing of the late showman's estate. CBS's unauthorized version, which had strong input from Liberace's quote-unquote business manager, arrives next week. Andrew Robinson, whose most famous part to date was the psycho in Dirty Harry, acquits himself nicely in the title role of this biography, which traces the flamboyant piano man's career from his teen years to his death of AIDS in 1987. The production benefits greatly from the use of Liberace's jewelry and wardrobe, as well as his famed piano-shaped pool. Movies and miniseries covering the same ground are nothing new for television. It's just unusual seeing them show up back-to-back week after week.
So there were two Liberace movies.
Yes, rival Liberace movies.
It was ABC, or is it NBC? Who was doing the first one?
This was ABC doing the first one.
So there's a little shade in that. They're saying like, oh, well, we have permission to do it.
We're using his real jewelry and pool.
Yeah, they're like, oh, we're real and we're first. And then they're throwing shade at the other one. They're like, well, just some business
his
manager.
His business manager, which they put in quotes, has sold his story.
So basically this is like the fluff one.
Yes, this is the official.
And then
estate.
The other one is like going to get into the nitty gritty of him. How exciting.
It's because like we had that with the Amy Fisher story as well. Remember there was four different rival Amy Fisher things. It was like who was involved, sold their story. Everyone has like a Rashomon on five different channels.
And they didn't check in with each other to see who was doing what.
Nope. Yeah. But this one, the thing that fascinates about this is he only died in 87, and they've already made two TV movies a year later, less than a year later. That's a pretty quick turnaround.
Yeah. I mean, they really jumped on it.
I can't think of anyone who's had that since. Like, could you imagine someone who died, like they made a David Bowie movie like 6 months after he died on TV or something, or like a Prince movie?
I'm trying to think if that's ever happened.
I can't think of any. I'm sure it has. But no one I can think of. It's really bizarre.
I mean, nowadays, I feel like they'll just go for the documentary.
Yeah, it's much cheaper.
And there's also a lot more, I think, legal stuff, too, to sort through.
For, like, liability and all that stuff. Because, the production stuff's well. Oof, man.
It's a lot of paperwork.
Do you enjoy doing that end of it?
No, I hate
it. Yeah, it's just kind of...
I mean, you're basically like a baby. You're just a... babysitter wrangler.
Right.
Like, and I don't mean that like, cause you've got, like, I remember, I think the moment when I was working as a producer and I realized that like, oh, when I'm an actor, I'm not getting a trailer cause they think I'm so special. Like I think I am. I'm getting a trailer because I am a prop with free will that's very expensive and they need me to do the thing that they want me to do.
Yes.
And I'm not no one's looking at me like I'm a person, but they're pretending that way so that I feel special. And so once I remember when I had that revelation, it like started to work way more as an actor. Cause it was like, oh, it's not really about me.
Yeah.
And the actor, unless you're a top line actor who's like bringing money to the project, you're kind of one of the last components that gets thrown in.
Right. They don't want you wandering off cause it'll ruin their shoot.
Yeah. But it's not just, an actor, you're going to make sure that you have a whole crew there. You're going to make sure the crew is happy and fed and address problems. And there's like so much paperwork and legality that's just really, really boring.
It's like being the director of a summer camp.
Yeah.
kids have fun at camp. And the director doesn't.
You need a permission slip from everyone.
yeah. Some kid's got poison ivy. We got to make sure he doesn't get hurt. Yeah. Kid got stuck, got caught with smuggled candy. You know, all these things that happen on film sets.
Yeah, except usually it's like a flask of booze in like a grip's pocket or something like that.
He smuggled in some people into his room.
I'm kidding. It's never the grips that are. It's like it'll be an actor.
Grips want to work again. Yeah. It's not that people don't think about it.
On some of the low, like a union grip is there, but like on sometimes we would have, you know, a small budget, so you'd bring in like some guy off Craigslist,
right?
And you know, he's like, yeah, I can grip, and then like wouldn't know what to do. And
check out this grip, I won't let go.
Yeah, it's like out, you know, and it's like, how did you get burned? I thought you wear your gloves, you know? And it's like, well, I usually am an AC. I'm like, no, that's a different way.
That's not the same thing. There's a lot of faking it till you maybe making it here.
I did that, like, to get to be a producer. I remember being in a meeting and they wanted someone who had contract experience. And they're like, have you done that before? And I'm like, yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah. And then I immediately left and like went to Barnes & Noble and bought a book on contracts. And like, how do I do this?
That's the actor in you. You're able to convince them that you were a contract.
I guess. Yeah. But I'm also a terrible liar, like as a person. So really? I'm not good at lying.
But you could, that's interesting. So like acting comes naturally.
Well, because it's a character.
True.
And so you're not I mean, the character might, but I'm making choices that the character would make.
Right.
But just me in real life, like,
can't lie.
I can't lie. I get real weird when I get caught lying too, or if like someone asks me something and I'm trying to lie, I'm like,
the story doesn't check out.
I'll flutter my eyelids and.
Oh, you got tells.
You
got,
like, are you okay? Yeah. Are you,
like, I'm riddled with lie tells. It's
I don't want to answer this question.
Wasn't worth it. So that's Sunday. And I will scan this ad.
There's also, let's talk to Gary Shandling and Tracy Ullman. Yes. And also wrestling were on Sunday.
Yeah. The It's Gary Shandling Show was ridiculously groundbreaking. I don't know if you remember it, but it was, he'd talk to the camera. He would mention that it was a sitcom. It, you know, as a kid in Boston who was as far away from anything exciting as you can imagine, it weirdly kind of taught me how sitcoms are made. Cause they were like, it was sort of like inadvertently educational.
Yeah.
It's because they're bringing it down.
So self-aware. And
And Tracy Ullman was such a great sketch show.
Yeah. That's how The Simpsons came to be, right?
They were the interstitials. They actually had three different cartoons, and The Simpsons was the one that they made into a special. And that show was so weird because it would sometimes have dramatic sketches. Mm-hmm. Like, they weren't even funny, like on purpose. Very, very weird.
And she came, didn't they both come back with like Netflix or something?
Yeah. She's done a ton of shows like that, a lot for HBO, but she never really comes up. She's constantly working and everyone's like, oh yeah, I know who Tracy Ullman is, but like just doesn't. The only movie I can think of her even being in is, was it that Dirty Shame, the John Waters movie?
Well, she doesn't really have time to be in a movie. She's making her own show.
That's true. Or maybe so her music career is still doing well.
Yeah.
They don't know. Monday night, what'd you go with?
Yeah, Elf.
Yes. 88, you had to go Elf. You had to go Elf. A weird show.
Super weird.
Yeah. Doesn't hold up. Which isn't surprising, probably.
No. Elf was the worst.
He was a real jerk.
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, and so was Willy, though.
But he was fuzzy, so it's like you were forgiving.
Did you have the Elf doll?
I had an Elf doll.
Yeah. I think that was like a like they just handed them out to people.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite TV doll that you had as a kid? Was it Elf? Or did you have a Rainbow Bright or something?
Oh, I had a Rainbow Bright. What else did I have? I guess I had a lot of like nondescript stuffed fuzzy thing. I had a Gizmo.
Oh, a Gizmo that's a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That one I really liked.
Everyone I knew who had a dog less than 30 pounds named it Gizmo for a good 15 years after that movie came out.
They still do.
Yeah, they probably still
do. And I also had Kermit and Miss Piggy from Muppet Babies.
Oh, yes. They were from Burger King. Were they the Christmas, the little ones that came from Burger King?
They were about this big, actually. They were.
Yeah. You had the high-end ones.
Well, they just were bigger.
Yeah.
And didn't come with a Happy Meal. Yeah. Or a Burger King kids meal. It was a
Burger King kids meal, yeah. I love those ones where they're in, like, weird Christmas outfits. Because they had a Fozzie. I was a big Fozzie guy.
Oh, Fozzie's great.
Yeah. Although my favorite, Rolf.
Oh, I love him.
I went to the...
What's he up to?
I went to the Museum of the Moving Image in Queens, New York, mm-hmm. and they have a standing Jim Henson exhibit. And when you walk in, there's Rolf. And it's Rolf. It's actual Rolf. And I immediately was like, ah, like, it was totally took me by surprise.
We had a big Jim Henson thing here.
Oh, recently, right?
Yeah. Was it the Skirball? I want to say I missed it.
It's, if you're back in New York at all, go to the, they also have David Bowie's costume from Labyrinth and Jennifer Connelly's costume from Labyrinth.
Which one? The ball gown or?
No, not the ball gown. The like her, the one she's in most of the time, the sort of jeansy weird pirate shirt thing. Yeah. And notes from Labyrinth, tons of stuff from Labyrinth. But Rolf really, I was like, wow. Cause he just looks like a carpet. But I'm like, it's Rolf. Because when you see him not from the waist up, it's really wide. Because so they could put a person in there. Oh, and, yeah. But I'm still like, there he is. Yeah. Underrated Rolf. Yeah. Muppet Baby is also a great show.
Love that one.
I was disturbed as a kid because they created Skeeter for the Muppet Babies.
They did.
And I didn't know that Muppet Babies chronologically was made after the Muppets. Because why would you? And I was like, what happened to Skeeter? They never talk about her when they're adults. She never gets mentioned. She's just missing. It really, really bothered me.
I guess I never put that together.
Maybe I just had too much time on my hands as a kid, but it kept me up at night sometimes.
You're like, where is Skeeter? Yeah. Why doesn't anyone?
They talk about her. They're not like, we miss Skeeter or like the accident. Like, were they all in on it? Like, how was Skeeter? What happened to her?
She just ran away.
Maybe she just left that life. She's like,
she just
nope.
Moved to another town.
She might have.
They lost her phone number.
Changed her name. Yeah.
Or they just lost her number.
They could have. Yeah. They're just like, oh, what's Skeeter up to?
Because that was the thing in the 80s. It's like if you met a friend somewhere and you got their number and you lost that piece of paper it was written on, you were probably never going to contact that person again.
Or they moved to a different number. Like, it's so easy to find people now. Yeah. Like, you could Google at like anyone's house where you're there. It's kind of convenient, but also terrifying. But yeah, you really would never get in touch with that person again.
I remember having a friend as a kid who moved away to like another state. And then that was just it. It was like, my friend's moving. Done. And then it was like, oh, that person's not in your life anymore. And then getting a letter from them like years later in the mail and then being, and then not even writing back because I just...
It's going to take years to go by. Well, I mean, when you're a kid too, like a year is like 10 years. Like you're such a different person since the last time you saw them. The only way to find people back then was to send a long distance dedication to American Top 40. That was the only way to find people.
How many of those did they actually put through?
I mean, they must've got a ton. They had two per episode. So they probably got tens of thousands.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was your only chance.
Yeah. Cause you know, there's people who are sending them every week.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to keep sending this in until I find that girl I talked to. That was how you do misconnections. You had to dedicate a song to them on a nationally syndicated radio show. You couldn't just post on Craigslist.
Hope that someone that they knew was listening and put it together.
And goes, man, they dedicated a Warrant song to me. I better get in touch with them.
Yeah. She's my cherry pie.
I loved how inappropriate the songs would always be because it'd be this like heartbreaking story. I used to have a Tumblr once of just, I would transcribe them. Mm-hmm. And there was one about these kids who blew up on a tractor and were also little people, which was like thrown in at the end. And the song that got dedicated was Billy Ocean, When the Going Gets Tough, which I guess like... The title kind of makes it, but it's this like, dun, 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 dun,
dun, dun, dun. Don't get stuck.
And I'm like, this is like just cruel. It's like cruel irony to give this song to this harrowing story.
But you know that it was probably like meant in earnest.
Which
is just even funnier.
They sincerely were like, I want to dedicate this song to them for being so brave. But it was just, Elf says, yo, Earthlings, the new season is here and the fur is going to fly. Get ready for first run fun. Elf gets the season off to a hairy start. I don't know if Elf, I mean, I would have watched Elf anyway because you had to, but just teasing something as a hairy start isn't going to make me go, oh, I got to see that.
No. I mean, I don't know that I would have even read that. I would have been like, I probably would have just saw first run and checked that it was on the same day and then done.
The Hogan's Open, some funny surprises. Do they just write these 6 months before the episode was made? Because there's nothing specific.
It's funny.
It'll work. This is really, I love this Nick at Night ad to what we were talking about before. I don't know if you saw it, but it's made like a diner menu, and it says Nick at Night classic dinner snacks. And it has the menu and nutritional content as the lineup for the night.
Oh, Donna Reed show,
which I really like.
Yeah. I really like the Donna Reed show too.
SCTV, which is my all time favorite, sketch show. Best of Star Aren't Live, Laughing, Car 54, which is maybe my favorite sitcom. Love that show. Make Room for Daddy, which is terrible. Nan Southern, which I don't like. But the rest of the night, very good.
The last two I didn't watch probably because they were on too late.
Midnight and 12:30.
My bedtime.
Yeah. Net weight says exceedingly light, which is true. Yeah. That's some good stuff. Anything on, where were we, Tuesday?
Yeah, I didn't write anything down for Tuesday. I don't know if it's because I forgot or just might was be boring. Nothing. Wasn't it like the movie night?
Yeah, they would do premiere movie night. So there's a movie with Patrick Duffy called Unholy Matrimony.
No relation.
Based on a chilling true story of obsession and murder. He's after a man who married for money. Insurance money.
Yeah, I wouldn't have watched that.
No, that looks like something boring.
What? Was there anything on cable? That might have been a cable night.
Tuesday night could have been a cable night. Well, Win, Lose, or Draw premieres that night. Executioner's Song.
I didn't
song.
Like playing Win, Lose, or Draw like in real life. I hated never that mind too. Watching other people play it.
Or being having it filmed. Like I would just, I'm not a game show person.
Me neither.
Where are we on cable? We have not a lot. Less than zero. Real bum out.
Yeah.
HBO is showing Flowers in the Attic. Jesus Christ.
Oh, I did watch Flowers in the Attic.
But not a movie that you'd want to revisit.
I think I've watched it a couple times, really? Actually. Yeah, I remember really liking it.
Did you see the remake?
I didn't see the remake, yeah. No. Because I liked the first one so much.
Christy Swanson. And it is. And it is. That and they handled the incest tastefully.
I thought so, too.
Yes, yeah.
In my nine-year-old brain or whatever.
Because that was the big thing. Like, they, even if you were a kid and you didn't pick up on that from the book, like, every single story about that was like, how dare they make this? And, it was handled fairly tastefully. Mm-hmm. There's also a world premiere movie called Jessie. The town needed her help. She was arrested for giving it. After 9 years of delivering babies, treating illnesses, and saving lives, she must now face an emergency of her own. That's it.
Oh, Jesse.
Yeah, Jesse.
Who played Jesse?
It was Lee Remick.
Oh.
Practicing medicine. She never... Oh, this is interesting. She never had an actual medical license.
Oh,
that
boy.
Was the thing,
that
based on a
like
true story.
Malpractice.
Yeah, you know, lawsuit. I'm like, yeah, she did some good, but, you know, you probably should have a medical license.
She sounds... She's just maybe like... A witch.
She could have been a witch.
Yeah.
Like a faith healer.
Yeah.
Well, that's like getting a grip on Craigslist.
Yeah. Does she have, did they mention crystals in there anywhere?
No,
did
crystals.
Maybe she did the healing with crystals.
That's huge out here, isn't it?
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I was never a crystal person. I was like, that is bullshit. And then I had to swear.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've been like trying.
I forgot to tell you. Yeah,
I've been like whispering them. Yeah. And then this year... I was like at a brunch and I had a little mimosa and then there was a crystal shop next door in Hollywood and my friend was like, we should go in there. And I'd been going through like just some like my eighth job in a row that didn't go my way. And I was like, ah. And she's like, I think we should go in the crystal shop. And I'm like, but I had a mimosa and then I start wandering around and then I look at this table of pink rose quartz. And I'm like, that one, that's the one that's speaking to me. And it was $10 and I bought it. And I carry it in my purse.
Do you find it helpful?
I mean, I don't know. Like, I don't know that like bad things would happen to me if it wasn't on me. Like, I don't really know.
It's not hurting.
Yeah. It's just basically just a little tiny pink rock in my bag.
Yeah.
So.
You're not alone. I know a lot of people who've more or less told me the same story with or without the mimosa, but pretty much that same thing. I was like, yeah, it's bullshit. But anyway, I have a bunch.
Yeah. Well, and then I've gotten them as gifts at different times. And so, like, I have a little bowl by my nightstand. It's just, like, some pretty rocks.
Yeah. I mean, pretty rocks are nice. We all had a rock tumbler as a kid growing up from that aunt. We never... Really?
Everyone had one and I didn't get one?
I'm sorry to ruin things for
you. Oh, my God. Yeah. Wait, what? Your parents loved you enough to give you a rock tumbler?
Oh, God, no. This was the aunt I never saw. This was the, like, send them an educational gift.
That's
amazing.
I loved educational gifts.
Really? Like the science museum gift shop style gifts?
Oh, they were amazing.
Yeah, like a puzzle of dinosaur bones. Astronaut ice cream, rock tumbler.
Yeah, give me a challenge. Yeah. Give me something to build or something to make. You know?
3D puzzle of the Eiffel Tower. That was always a big one.
I remember having one of those like kitchen play sets and just being so frustrated that I couldn't really kitchen with it. Yeah. Like, I'm like, I want that oven to work.
I want to make some French fries right now.
Oh, they're delicious. Yeah.
My sister wasn't allowed to cook. She was younger than me, but my parents didn't care what I did with the stove. So I spent a good year and a half in high school trying to perfect a sugar cookie recipe, which really explains why I was a late bloomer dating. Because
That sounds delicious.
Yeah, I mean, now as adults in this day and age, sure, but in high school, like rushing home after school because you had a revelation in English class about vanilla is probably not the thing that's really gonna impress people.
I mean, I don't know, those were my friends.
Well, I should have gone to high school with you then, because man, it wasn't popular.
When I said friends, it was the ones in my head. I didn't really.
Yeah,
I was rushing home to take to work on a dance
on piece. A dance routine. Yeah. Well, we all, and look how great we're doing now.
I'm okay.
Yeah, we're doing fine. And it's not all the rose quartz. Yes. Wednesday night, you went Unsolved Mysteries. I imagine you had to.
Oh, yeah. Unsolved Mysteries. Also that week, there was a vice presidential debate.
Yes, which is also a bit of an unsolved mystery.
Yeah.
Where we had everybody's friend, Dan Quayle.
Dan Quayle.
So cute now when we think about it.
Well, and then Bent, like, I don't...
Yeah.
The other guy, Dan Quayle, is still... You still remember his name.
Yeah, Lloyd Benson. Benston. Who was a senator, I think, and he was Dukakis's running mate. That was 92 that Quayle went on that rant about Murphy Brown and how awful it was that she was a single mother in the debate. And then everyone was like, but this was after the potato thing. That year was the first election I remember. Like, I don't remember the 84 one. This one I was, like, aware enough.
The 84 one was Reagan.
It was Reagan, and I forget who he was against, even. It was Reagan's second term.
Yeah.
But this was the first one I remember was a thing. And I don't know if it was because Dukakis was like from Massachusetts and was, like, the former governor. Mm-hmm. So they just got more. I don't know. Maybe. But I might have just been older. But the first thing I remember is Dukakis in that tank. There's famous footage of him. They were saying he was weak in the military, so he had a parade where he came out in a tank and he lifted it up and he's got a helmet on and everything. And people were like, this actually hurt you more than not doing it.
Yeah. Like, no, don't do that.
No.
Don't.
No.
Yeah. And people actually, like, train really hard to be able to do that. Yeah.
And
like,
no one's buying it there, Mike. In that same month.
Designer suit.
Yeah. It's like, hey, hello. Samantha Fox did the same thing that month.
Samantha Fox?
Yes.
Like the singer?
Yeah. The singer, Page Three model.
But I bet she was wearing something sexy.
Very sexy. And that was like a parody they did of Dukakis doing this. And everyone was like, wow, Samantha Fox pulled it off way more than you did. actually,
well,
She was a fox. And in 88, she was on the Nightmare on Elm Street 5 soundtrack, The Dream Master.
Yeah.
She had a song called Now I Lay Me Down that is filthy. And I was very, very convinced I was going to get in trouble for listening to it.
You know what I'm going to listen to on the way
you
home.
You should. You'll enjoy it. You know what? You might be shocked at how filthy it is.
I'm going to have to revisit it.
Yeah.
A lot of filthy songs went over my head when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Like, I just, because I took them at face value and I didn't get. Yeah. Like, I remember... It was maybe for kindergarten, first grade. We were asked to bring in to school our favorite song.
Okay.
So at the time for me, it was Billy Idol's Rebel Yell.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's my favorite song. I love the guitars.
It's a good song.
It's great. It still holds up. It's amazing.
Steve Stevens, I think.
I remember putting my mom would make copies of like albums. And so I remember putting the cassette tape in my bag and then she was putting my lunch in there and she found it and she's like, what's this? And I was like, oh, we have to bring in our favorite song. And she was like, well, you can't bring that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, but it's my favorite song. And she's like, well, I don't carry it. And she switched it out with like the Muppets soundtrack or something. And it was the first time that I felt artistically repressed.
Yeah, you got
someone.
Censored.
Yeah, because I was like, no, but that's yes, I also like the Muppets.
Yeah.
I agree. That's great. But this is my favorite song.
That was not
and
the brief.
Now you're going to make me go in and lie.
Yeah, you can't lie.
And be inauthentic.
Yeah.
Yeah, no. And so then I was just like embarrassed.
Was it that she cries more was the part that she had a problem with?
Well, the whole thing is about, it's about screaming during sex.
That's
so it's like, you know, maybe your 4-year-old daughter shouldn't be listening to that. But I didn't know. It was just, I thought it was about shouting and having a fun time.
Yeah, and she.
And I love to shout.
She added an element now you go, oh, I wonder what it is about.
At the time, I didn't even wonder why. I just. I thought like as a child, I judged a lot of my mom's decisions and her logic. I'd be like, well, that doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Or, you know, what is she hiding from me?
She's clearly wrong. Yeah. Yeah.
And so it wasn't until later I was like, oh, that's why she did it.
Thank you, Mom. Yeah.
No, not
yeah.
thank no, you. Still not thank you. I still would have stood by it.
Yeah. I think you would have just come across as really cool in school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the guitar solo.
Oh, yeah.
It's so great.
Yeah. I assure you, the Samantha Fox, Now I Lay Me Down, is not that coded.
Okay.
It's a little more explicit.
I'm excited to hear it. Columbo was on that night.
Yes. It's a Columbo made for TV movie. John Cassavettes is in this one.
Whoa.
As a maestro who kills his mistress and passes it off as suicide.
Wow.
That sounds really engaging.
Yeah, I would watch that.
Have you ever seen the movie Incubus with John Cassavetes?
No.
It's a really weird early 80s horror movie about an actual incubus that's like killing women. And John Cassavetes is like the city coroner who's like, something's wrong here. And it's real weird.
Oh, wow.
It's real weird. It's not quite possession weird, but in that realm.
He's so great in Rosemary's Baby.
He truly is, yeah.
It's one of my favorite horror films.
Have you ever seen his show Johnny Staccato?
No.
So in the late 50s, early 60s, John Cassavetes starred as like a beatnik detective who played guitar and was named Johnny Staccato. And it's really cool.
All right. Yeah. I should be taking notes of all this.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm giving you
all... go and look up online.
All kinds of homework here.
Not homework. Like, enjoy work.
Well, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where are we? Thursday?
Yeah. Oh, we glossed over the fact that the A-Team was on that night, too.
Yeah, but... final season of the A-Team. This is an aggressive land developer threatens a local truck stop. Hey, guess what? That's every episode of the A-Team.
Yeah.
Land developers were the villain of the 80s.
Yeah. Still are.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
I think so. I just wish we had more vigilante groups of ex-POWs who would take them down. Or breakdancers, like in Breakin' 2.
Oh, God. I love Electric Boogaloo.
Yeah. Get on top of that bulldozer and dance it away.
Yeah, I mean, you can dance a lot of problems away.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, not the Muppets, but the Fraggles. You know, dance your cares away. The worries for another day, you know? I mean, it's right there in the song. I didn't know how literal they were. I thought it was more of internal cares, but if you can dance things away physically.
But imagine, like, any conflict that you're in.
Yeah.
If you just began dancing in front of the person you're in the conflict with,
yeah,
it would totally change everything.
And they wouldn't have to be like, wow, they know capoeira. They would just be like, you know what? You're all right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, there's some hints of Martha Graham in there, but I'm also seeing Bob Fosse.
Yes. Modern, yet classic.
Yeah. I love the blending of the street dance and the ballet technique.
Yes.
It's like Russian ballet technique and spinning on your head together. It's at last.
It's like breakdance in Baryshnikov.
Yeah.
Which I always used to get the name of Kalashnikov guns wrong when I was a kid and would call them Baryshnikovs. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what a gun that was called a Baryshnikov would do, but I kind of want to know.
Yeah.
Just dance. It's a dance gun.
It would be fierce.
You spray, sure. You shoot people with it, and then they dance. Thursday night.
Oh, oof. The big thing we watched on Thursdays was the Cosby Show.
Yep. This is kind of creepy.
Look at his face. I can't even look at.
It says the new season is finally here, and you know what that means. And it's a big picture of Cosby. And then you turn the page, and it says fresh air.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Yeah, that's bad. That is bad. So we'll skip. Different world.
Yeah, that was great.
This is when Dwayne Wayne and Whitley kind of hooked up. This was the world they want. Actually, that's a good example of a show that was okay after the they got married though later and it was bad. And Dear John, this is the premiere. It has one of the most sad opening songs. It's just his Dear John letter sung by the woman who left him. So it's like, Dear John, by the time you read this note, I'll be gone. It's just Judd Hirsch being sad, reading a Dear John letter every week.
Yikes.
His wife took the gold mine and gave him the shaft. That's an unusually on the nose description there.
I feel like Dear John could be due for a comeback.
I think it would work now. I think it would work now because it was a support group for lonely single people. Yeah, which I don't even know if they still have those. I guess that's why social media exists.
No, they do.
Do they?
Like a friend of mine is a psychologist, and he does this like co-ed group therapy thing. And I guess it's not just specifically for singles, but
right.
It's a way for people to kind of talk about things that they're dealing with. And he does it, I think, like once a week, and it's like $50 or something, and it's pretty much open to anyone who wants to come.
Yeah.
And so it does exist.
Yeah, because that's about what this is. They meet in like a high school after hours, and they're like, how did your week go? Did you talk to anyone? Like that kind of stuff. Also, the movie Night Kill is on, which is a made-for-TV movie with Robert Mitchum and Jacqueline Smith. And it's a pretty good horror movie, and there's a horrific death in that movie. Jacqueline Smith gets burned to death in the shower.
Oh, my God.
And it's
wait,
a TV
it had it in the shower?
Yeah. Yeah, like someone cranks the heat up so high that it kills her, which I don't think is a thing you can do. But the burn makeup is really graphic.
I mean,
and
you
it's
could scald. You could get scalded.
Scald to death, could, yeah.
Well, I don't know. It would kill. It would be, I feel like it would still be.
You'd want to die, maybe.
Well, the water heater would have to get hot. It would take a while.
It would take some tinkering. It wouldn't. You couldn't do it with an off-the-shelf water heater.
Yeah, you could scald. But I don't know that you would. Get third? I don't know.
Hey, anyone who knows about killing people with a shower heat level, write in and let us know how that
maybe,
can be done.
Maybe don't write, because I don't know that the people who know that really well are people we
want to associate.
Maybe just we don't want to hear from them.
Maybe we want to identify them so we know to avoid them. I remember seeing it when it aired on TV, and it's a made-for-TV movie, network movie, and I was like, this is really graphic.
They had network money. They could afford the special effects.
But they just didn't get like, oh, yeah, a woman getting scalded, that's fine. Just don't show too much of her boobs. That's a problem.
That's surprising to me that level of gore got through censors.
It got through, surprisingly. I've revisited a lot of made-for-TV movies lately, and ones that weren't advertised as a horror movie, like ones that were like ripped from the headlines, but it's a horror movie. They let everything go through. They were like totally cool with whatever in those.
Oh, wow.
Really weird. What else did you do that night?
48 hours.
48 hours that night. The news program that's still on. What is 48 hours?
It's like a crime, a true crime kind of mystery series.
Yeah, it started as they would go, we're going to follow one story 48 hours into the crime, and now it's just like a news magazine show. But the first season of that show was really interesting. Yeah. But the sort of scripted police procedurals have kind of taken over for that real thing.
Well, Dateline, NBC.
First 48. Yeah. Is that the one? Yeah. Which I guess is literally the same thing.
But then it led the way to like Serial, the podcast Serial, and then, you know, like Making a Murderer and all that stuff. And my favorite murder, like I think 48 Hours, it was when we were really starting to become obsessed with like the drama of real life crime.
A&E started doing a lot of serial killer stuff. Yeah, that really started bubbling up at that time.
I mean, I guess we always had that fascination, but 48 Hours is the first kind of that docu.
Well, it adds legitimacy to it too, because they're like, this is a news program.
Yeah.
Yeah, which it really isn't. Friday night.
What?
It's not news.
Oh,
well, I guess it's true because it's new. It's true, but it's totally sensationalized.
But isn't all news a little bit sensationalized?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So, yeah. But it's worse when it's like a murder because they're because they create that image of like the genius serial killer, which is not a thing for the most part.
Sometimes they're geniuses, the serial killers, no?
Not in real life. There's not a lot of Hannibal Lecters. They're just like some semi-clever, like who was Ted Bundy was a little bit clever in how he captured people, but they're not like this, I planned for this. They're not the Blacklist James Spader people.
No.
Who I think might be a killer. James Spader has that air about him.
He's just an actor.
He is like, just an actor. Just,
you're inherently like,
he's got that vibe though. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know him, but maybe he's really nice in real life.
Well, I had Andrew McCarthy on and he said that James Spader used to call him and leave like 40-minute voice messages, and he just takes so long to tell a story. And so Andrew McCarthy bought an answering machine in the mid-80s just to screen calls from James Spader. Like, they're still friends and everything, but he'd have these tapes of like, Andrew, it's James, I was at the supermarket, and they just go on and on and on. And I was like, please tell me you still have the Spader tapes.
Oh my gosh, yeah. His permission, and I would listen to that.
Animate him.
Yeah.
He said he still has them. He's going to look for them because I would love to hear those tapes.
Oh, I would totally watch that, or just even listen to it, like radio plays.
Yeah. Yeah. James Spader from the mid-80s just going on a weird rant. Friday night, there's a lot of specials tonight. Where'd you go?
Yeah, I just went Friday. That's what
just
I
have a Friday. Yeah,
Friday. There's like a circus.
Yep, the circus seven special. Wonders of the circus world. Thrills, comedy, and the best acts from unique circuses around the world. We have circus acts from France, Sweden, USA, Brazil, Italy, and Switzerland. Hosted by Harry Anderson. That's okay. I'd watch that.
Yeah, that's probably what I ended up watching that night.
Looks like we got tigers and trapeze artists and all kinds of stuff.
I love trapeze artists.
Oh, terrifies me. Yeah, I can't do high things.
Me neither, but it is so cool to watch.
It's cool. It's definitely cool to see. Yeah. Is there a circus act that you would do? Like, would you try it? Would you try the high wire or the trapeze?
I mean, I guess in doing dance, I like trained in silks. I took a couple of like pole dancing classes but not like in a, it's a really great like upper a core body strength. Work. Yeah. Like I did gymnastics when I was a little girl. And I quit only because at our exhibition at the end of the year, there was a clown and I never wanted to, clowns freak me out.
You don't need that shit.
Yeah. But I refused to go back cause I never wanted to see the clown again.
Which would be the problem with the circus.
Yeah. I mean, really, or maybe like the pretty girl in the sequins who rides the elephant who just waves.
It's like the princess die of the circus.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good move. That's a smart move.
That's probably something that I could handle without having a lot of anxiety.
Yeah. I think you can do it. We'll make some calls. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for doing this. It's been great talking.
God, my pleasure. How fun.
Yes.
And I'm going to go and watch like everything we talked about that
Let me know. Let me know how they hold up.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Absolutely.
There's Megan Duffy, and once again, I think Duffy is the most seen last name on the show. We had Chris Duffy, we had Julia Duffy, we had Megan Duffy, we had Karen Duffy, aka Duff. I think there might be another Duffy in there that I am forgetting about. But I think Duffy's the number one surname on the show. I'm sure a listener who has statistics will tell me if I'm right or wrong there. I want to thank Megan for being on the show. And again, check her out at Blumhouse's Fear Initiative podcast and see All Creatures Were Stirring, her Christmas horror comedy that is out December 4th. I'll also put links up to all our social media stuff on tvguidancecounselor.com. You can email me if you have any questions about the show or about old TV, or you have guest recommendations. You can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at ken@icanread.com. Ken Reed is spelled R-E-I-D, by the way, like Tim Reed. And I will get back to you as soon as I can, which is usually pretty quick. Also on iCanRead.com, we still have some TV Guidance Counselor merchandise, t-shirts, still a few work shirts left and all that stuff if you would like to buy any of that. Or you can go on the Patreon, as I mentioned before, that is patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. And I thank you again for those of you who contribute. It is a huge help and gets me these episodes in Los Angeles. So it is Halloween coming up. We may have a surprise. We may not. I don't know. And if I don't know, who does? But we'll see you again next time. So be sure to check in here and subscribe if you haven't. And while you're at it, if you want to rate and review the show, that would be great too. And I'm on Dana Gould's podcast again, the Halloween episode. Once again, an honor. I think this is the second one I've been on. And it is truly a dream come true. So if for some strange reason you aren't listening to Dana's podcast on the regular, you should be. And I am on this week's episode. So hopefully that doesn't ruin it for you. So we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Kind of. And if you set it to music and you took away the vomit and stuff, I'm like, it would actually be some, I feel like something that Peanut Bausch would put up.
Yeah.